Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our panel on Asset Managers Share Their Secrets. I'm Dan Sheline, Senior Vice President of Asset Management with Charters Lodging. And I'm pleased to be among a group of such talented, dynamic asset managers to my left and to my right. Okay, we've got a terrific cross-section of asset management disciplines at these two tables. And our goal here is to provide you guys with a little background on what asset management secrets we have. Let's get started on a fairly general question posed by one of our members. What is asset management?
I think that asset management has, after this last recession, become a very different game than it was previous.
No question about that. Barry.
Well, I'd like to first start with what it's not. I think we've all clearly learned that it's not regurgitating financial statements. That's not the job of, that is a job, it's certainly not what asset management is. I personally view asset management really as kind of an integrated approach to the oversight of the hotel, and really break that down into, I think, three specific areas that all have to work together to effectively asset manage. Certainly, oversight and understanding of the operations of the hotel. Management of CapEx and the physical building of the hotel and the renovation components. And third, really, what we'll generally call capital structure, but everything from of your actual capital structure to the more portfolio management kind of sell or hold decisions. And taking all those really as together as one integrated approach is what asset management is to me.
For us, as a third-party asset manager, we try not to look at what is the role as much as the objective. And for us, we look at asset management as creating value for the owner. When I say value, creating higher value of the property. So we improve the cash flow, improve the physical product or the capital structure, anything to make the hotel worth more.
As we're basically the liaison between the brand and the owner. When the brands decided few years back that they no longer wanted to be in the business of owning real estate, they created this nice little space for those of us at this panel where as long as the interest of the owner, which is to basically make money and create value, are slightly different than those of the brand, which will always be a space of the need for asset management. So that's
maybe the combination of all of the comments here really is a pretty good job description for what an asset manager does. I think one of the things we do a lot, because as Sanjeev mentioned, we do a lot of third-party asset management, and we do it for a lot of branded hotels. And what we find is that you have owner's equity, which we're trying to maximize and grow and do whatever we can to get the returns that our owners have underwritten and are trying to achieve with their investment. And then you've got brand equity, which is what Justin's talking about. The operators, although they do have a fiduciary responsibility to manage the hotel and do the best job that they can, they also have a fiduciary responsibility to their stock price and their shareholders. And so there's brand equity versus owner's equity. And our job as an asset manager, especially with branded hotels, is to find that common ground. It sounds real easy. Frankly, it is a little bit easier in an up cycle, not so easy in a down cycle. Everybody's fighting for that equity. The brands are fighting for their equity position in the down market, and the owners are fighting for the equity they had in this down market. Frankly, I think we've gone from value maximization, where you really are trying to do whatever you can to push the needle and push the value of your asset to really preserving the asset. So all intents and purposes is the ability to still control the asset to try to win your equity back as the recovery begins to take hold. A lot of our work right now has been mostly financial engineering, restructuring, dealing with my good friends, special servicers, dealing with my other good friends, attorneys, and really trying to do what we can in order to keep the equity in the game. And there's a lot of different things that we've done, which we'll talk about, I think, as we get into the panel discussion. But it's really, as I say, I guess fundamentally, it's the shift has been much more short-term focused in the work that we're doing versus maybe having a more intermediate or longer-term goal as to, what things can we do now in order to facilitate an exit and to maximize the returns at that exit. right now we're not really looking at exit. We're looking at just what can we do to stay in the game.
Really right now on the cusp of something really taking right off from what Chad had last said. Chad, let me just make sure I don't misquote you, but you know, really focused on, you know, the now and not focused on the end game. I think right now, and really what we've seen in the capital markets, and my business is a little bit different because we don't do third-party asset management. We're a pure investor, so we only asset manage properties that we have a direct equity investment in. But my sense is that if you're any owner right now, you should be looking at, is this a time to exit? I think we're seeing transactions occur at really interesting, we'll use the word interesting, pricing, and I think there are a lot of hotel owners who might be able to today maximize value out of the physical asset that they had no idea was there, really wasn't there even 6 months ago, let alone 12 months ago. So I think a key piece that asset managers really want to focus on, two things. One, is this a time to exit or recapitalize the deal? And two, in doing that, the market's clearly changed. We're seeing markets now that have significant occupancy compression. When you look at, you start looking at a week like last week and the market by market RevPARs, I mean, these markets are moving, and that what you really want to do now is make sure you're not just playing a can we fill the hotel game, but really figuring out, hey, if everybody's filling, well, maybe we ought to be the leaders of the let's move the rate up program.
You guys have a portfolio of full service and select service. Is there a difference or a nuance between asset managing a full service versus a select service hotel?
Well, a full service hotel, it has multiple revenue streams, and you have to be out in front of each of the potential revenue streams, be it rooms, food and beverage, golf. Whereas select service is a very straightforward proposition. You're going to market with usually a very quantifiable brand, and the delivery is pretty simple, if you will. Full-service hotels present a very different dynamic because you have to be able to keep all the plates going at the same time while someone's trying to trip their leg out from underneath. And this rate compression has pushed everybody into the middle. So the rate differentiation that he's being able to achieve between luxury and full-service and mid-scale and the economy has kind of moved into the center.
So a lot of blurriness.
It's very difficult to maintain your differentiation in this homogenous economy.
Asset management and lenders and brands. Tell me a little about the nuances and challenges between those two. Just again, kind of in a general form to get people going on asset management.
From a brand perspective, lenders like brands. They tend to like assets that are branded because they feel like down the line, they'll have more equity with perhaps those assets rather than perhaps an independent or a boutique hotel. So what we, and when we, within our portfolio, we work on both branded and independent properties. And the independent properties, it is a little bit of a struggle to get the lender to kind of see where the value is over time. But if you have the right processes and procedures in place, if you are looking at the right things, with respect to their labor models, et cetera. And if you're able to try to make the property as brand-like without being a brand, there is value there because there's obviously costs that go along with being a brand versus being an independent hotel. And buyers certainly always like unencumbered assets. So from a value standpoint, it's great to be able to sell the inherent value of an independent property. But lenders really do tend to cling to brands and wanting to have a flag on a hotel, particularly from their standpoint. I've worn both hats. I used to be on the mortgage asset management side with Prudential, and I could see where the lender would say, I want that Ritz flag on there, I want that Marriott flag on there. I could see that, but you know, kind of digging more into the operations from an asset management standpoint, there's definitely some inherent value there without the additional cost.
Earlier is what's changed in this cycle that makes it a little different than it used to be. And one thing we've seen in the last few years is a lot of non-traditional hotel people have entered the market. Raised funds, they've done other real estate, now they've come into the hotel sector. Just the perfect time to see, you know, revenues drop 20%. And so, you know, we deal with a lot of people that they've done a lot of work in other asset classes and are trying to understand who the players are and how brand, franchise, revenue, everything works together. And a lot of the lenders, we have you know, the traditional people who've been there, but a lot of regional banks that have one or two hotels in the portfolio. And a lot of the problems we've seen is you have an asset that needs a renovation to maintain a brand, and they're in distress, can't fund it. You know, what do they have to do? So it's an education process for the lender. As a third-party asset manager, it's interesting. I think people are more open that we can help them. There's a lot more creativity needed now. People are dealing with challenges that they never anticipated because of the lack of liquidity, financing, volatility. You know, the valuation of hotels changes every month based on what's happening in the macro economy. So they're more open to it, but at the same time, you know, lenders themselves are an asset manager. They want to bring in help, but the borrower may feel that they're a great operator, that they don't need the help, but you're still in a situation where the cash flow isn't there. So it's really a challenge of making sure that everyone's on the same page and they see each party as an asset, as a resource, and not as you know, someone there to watch and criticize.
Lenders are a great audience for asset managers. Because if they are in a situation where they've never worked on a hotel asset before, they really are receptive to a lot of the ideas that we put forward. And there are a couple of situations we're working on right now where, you know, we find them more interested perhaps than some of our traditional client base. They're really interested, they read our reports, and they are looking for the advice that we're giving them. So to that extent, the lender client base has really been good for us.
One of the missions of this particular panel was to try to understand the secrets that we used during this quote-unquote Great Recession. And I'd like to start again with Bob on my right and follow through all the way with Chad and having everybody give some brief points to the audience about what secrets you've been able to employ over the last 24 months.
Person who woke up in the emergency room after a bad heart attack, and the first thing we told the doctor is we're going to lay off the cigars and the cognac and we're going to take off 20 pounds. And we've been forced into a place where we're running our businesses very efficiently. And you know, our challenge going forward is going back to the emergency room heart attack analogy is to keep that up. Because if we return to our old habits and we return to our lifestyles, we're destined to go through the second again. And I don't know if we'll have that opportunity. I think that after every boom and bust cycle, there's some return to the cyclical relationship between supply and demand, and we all get a little heady again. And lenders, of course, there's always a new vehicle that makes plenty of capital available. And I think that we're going to see a much more regulated credit environment. What's been taking place in Washington, and I don't think we're going to see coming out of this cycle the ability to go out and borrow money on these promises and hope. I think you're going to be in a position where you're going to have to put up and show me that an environment as opposed to tell me about money. We maintained a relatively lean organization, and so for us the adjustment hasn't been as significant as it has been for the groups that fattened up. I think, you know, as we look across our portfolio, we're really happy with the brand decisions we've made. We're really happy with the real estate decisions that we've made because, you know, location, 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 and creating yourself with one of the better brands. If you get it right at that level, everything else tends to be very manageable. Top of the cycle.
I'm going to go a little bigger picture.
Sure.
And I think something that really the groups that did this in the downturn, I think, are seeing much, much better results more quickly, kind of coming out the other end. And I mentioned in my first commentary about, you know, what an asset manager is not. It's not somebody that just takes and regurgitates financial statements. Along with that, I think it's kind of this old-time classic notion of the asset managers as a adversary. The way a lot of people historically asset managed hotels was us against you and owner against manager and those kinds of things. And I think the people that are seeing success coming out of this are the people that actually viewed their hotels and the relationship holistically and from both sides, from the owner side and from the manager and or brand side, and that these were problems that we needed to tackle together as an industry, but also specifically at the property level. And in my mind, the very best asset managers have been those that have really integrated themselves with the property management teams to really focus on those business issues that matter, and in a way that's a very pure kind of learning experience. And I think owners that took the time to talk with their management companies and their general managers and their controllers about, hey, here's this hotel. Here's how much we paid for it. Here's how much in debt we put on it. Here's how much our debt service is this month. And here's where the gap is. And how can we all work together to bridge that gap? Stood a much better chance and are doing a much better job of really having dug in to make it really a team-oriented approach. All right. I just took in a downturn. We've all got to figure out what it takes to get out of this. In the upmarket, I'm happy to, I call it more of a jockey philosophy, and I'm happy to crack the whip and push things really hard to get to that next level, particularly if the property's already performing at a level that where there's some complacency and people believe that they have achieved what their goals are, what their management goals are, what their budget was for the year, whatever it is. I think I'm much more willing to, and I think companies should be much more willing, and owners should be much more willing, to push properties much harder in the upside.
Show another example of that. We asked her basically to move, and we asked her to manage the Palmer House here in Chicago. We asked her to move on site for about a 6-month period, and she did that. And we really did see where that exponentially moved the bar on a really aggressive cost containment initiative plan at that property. And not only did it help the property kind of reach its goals, but it also helped her career in terms of allowing her to get that experience of really collaborating with the team. So I wholeheartedly agree that really digging into the asset and having a collaborative effort with the team really can, especially in the downtime, really help out long term. We sort of normally come in kind of for that first owner's meeting, and I think if you set the table and make it very clear that we're not coming in to be, you know, adversarial, we're not the old-fashioned fist pounders, as they call them, you know, we're coming in to have a collaborative relationship. Mm-hmm. I think that helps set the table. They sometimes will be a little bit leery of whether you're actually truthful about that or not, and then the rest is really developing and cultivating that relationship.
The reason they're having challenges are the same. Revenue is down, not an ability to refinance, having capital issues. But every owner is dealing with different issues right now. And it's important that the operator and the team at the property, you know, are understanding what that objective is. That maybe we don't have the capital right now to do the renovation because we have to work out issues with the lender. Or we're delaying something or moving something around. And, you know, I think Barry hit it on the nail. It's a lot easier to be able to tell your GM that we are freezing salaries and we're going to make our food and beverage outlets work with 4 managers instead of 6, because here's the cost of running the hotel, here's what we pay our lender, here's what we have to deal with every month. And when they understand that it's not just some innocuous company or fund, but these are the real fundamentals of the profit and income, they're more apt to get online with it. I think one of the important things as an asset manager, just because you make a recommendation doesn't mean you're going to affect the profitability and the performance of the property. If they're not on the same page, they're not going to implement it. They're not going to buy in. You know, I think you asked what changed. You know, the people who've been successful made pretty proactive changes in 2008, redefined the way they did business. You hoping that things will return in 12 or 24 months is great. But you have to make changes today to make sure you have the cash flow to pay your debt. So everyone on the same page, everyone's a team player. My job is great if I make the management company look like superstars. And that's what we try to do. A lot of companies that are traditionally good operators got caught in development, you know, doing new projects, and kind of moved the needle away from operations a little bit. So some of the simple things, if the fundamentals aren't done, then we're going to have problems on liquidated capital. So are you contesting your real estate taxes? Is your payroll numbers in line? Have you renegotiated your vendor contracts? Is all of your pricing and mechanics of the property? So first, focus on the fundamentals. And you know, in Paramount in Chicago, we reviewed 140 hotels first quarter this year, and more than half of them having contested real estate taxes in 5 years, or 3 years, sorry, which was a big shock to me. Simple things have to be done. I think the second thing is not to overreact to the cycle. One of the challenges we talked about, everyone's losing occupancy, let's drop rate. Marriott, if we don't drop rate, Holiday Inn's gonna steal our business. Hampton Inn, if we don't drop rate, Comfort Inn's gonna steal our business. That doesn't tie in to what the brand is providing for you. And so a lot of people were so aggressive on dropping rates, and they're scared to price back to what their product is in the marketplace. And I think that's a real challenge this year, is getting your team that you said, don't lose the business, whatever it takes, whatever it takes. Now they're scared to price aggressively in a market where you have a better product. So I think the ADR pricing and making sure that sales and marketing efforts are trackable. If I have a billboard, if I have a campaign with TravelClick, if we're doing something with Expedia or hiring a Blitz team, we need to know what the return is on that investment. So everything has to be trackable and justified. You know, I think there's 100 different things,
there
not
are,
two or three big ones.
24 months ago, and what did CHM do to prepare for and try to gain any visibility of a crystal ball back in late 2009 and then through?
Your operator ought to be doing employee service scores, doing it at least every 6 months, if not at least annually. How are the employees doing? Are they happy? Is there a high level of turnover? Because if you have a high level of turnover, that's a high cost to bring people in from a recruitment standpoint and a training standpoint. So employee satisfaction is an important thing to monitor, especially in a down cycle like this, because you're asking a lot of people to probably do a lot more for less. And if you're gonna ask them to do that, you gotta measure that. You gotta make sure you're not asking too much. I think the brands in two areas have done well by most operators or owners, excuse me. The two areas I think they've been somewhat responsive to is, one, I think they've tried to, and they've gotten a little bit burned in the media on this, but they've tried to relax their brand standards. And, number of outlets open, room service is a prime example. It's a 24-hour room service. They cut the hours back to, 16 hours and things of that nature. So I think they've tried to relax their brand standards where they could to try to reduce the cost structure in the hotel, and I commend them for that. I think they've also tried to work with you on CapEx. I can tell you there isn't a hotel I have right now that's current with any of the traditional CapEx that we normally be doing. And they've been working with us very openly on trying to do the things that you had to do and the things that you could push off and you push off. And so I think from that standpoint, they've done a good job.
What do you do when they roll out SFO or SS?
Unfortunately, us third-party guys at this table don't usually have quite the muscle that perhaps a REIT does that, may have several of a particular brand that rolls out a particular initiative. But you try to get in there on behalf of your owner and sit down to the table and kind of discuss the initiatives and get them to come to you with where they see the value in this program. And you definitely hold them to the fire in terms of the cost neutral thing. And as soon as you start seeing it creep up, you call them out on it, and you definitely make your presence known.
For example, revenues are down 18%, 20%. Their biggest promotion is how many people can your front desk sign up for the rewards program? And we'll measure it every month. And we're going to fine you if you don't have people signed up. And so it's great that they relaxed standards and they took half a point off your sales contribution. But there's a disconnect on those franchise reps in your market. And the biggest frustration I've always had is you don't have consistency in brand. Some brands are better than others, but franchise sales is not always in line with brand strategy. And like Justin said, you may have a 25-year-old Hampton Inn that gets a 5-year renewal because the owner is a REIT that has 50 properties. Or you're forced to spend $2 million when another property, the brand standards have been relaxed and they have been kicked out of the system. That hurts you. What I think the concern for owners moving forward is how are the brands going to relax their strategies in the next 18 months to get new distribution? You built a brand new courtyard, whatever the product is, are they going to allow a conversion that dilutes the brand in your market? So, I think everyone's in the same plate, they benefit when we benefit, but I think the consistency could be better.
We're now entering an interesting phase in the cycle. It's almost similar to teaching your son or your daughter to ride a bicycle. It's just about there, and then a complete crash, and then, you know, we got to start over, and then a little further of a trend gets going. The market wants to come back. People want to travel. Occupancy is coming back. ADR, depending on the market. We've seen some signs of massive ADR growth, e.g. New York. We've seen other signs where it's actually decreased year over year still. We want to try to have some strategy thinking here for the upcycle. We'd like, again, to have you guys give us and share your secrets on what you're planning to do and how to execute a successful recovery strategy.
Because I think for me, the key, at least in the near term, to the upside is an individual property's ability to revenue manage. And I think to revenue manage well, I mean, revenue management at the end of the day, in large part, is a game, right? And you've got to, and to win it, you've got to only not know what you should do, but also what your competitors are doing. So we're really focused on getting our managers back out into the markets to understand who their competitive set is, why that's the competitive set, who the owners of those properties are, who the management companies of those properties are, what their financial position is. I mean, are they in a position where they don't care if rates low as long as they're generating some level of cash flow? What kind of condition is the property in relative to renovation? And also, as best they can, get inside and understand the other general managers in the market and what they think their strategies are. In no way am I suggesting, to be very clear, to talk to those general managers about those strategies, but I'm suggesting that they really understand what they think the market's going to do, because unfortunately, we've continued to prove that we are only as good at setting rates as what our competitive set hotels are doing, and understanding what their reactions may be, understanding when and why they fill, will give you a lot more insight into how to set your revenue management strategy than, oh, this is what came out of the black box, these are the rates we're running, this is what the regional revenue manager told us to run. I think, and the properties that are successful right now and will prove to have been best practice hotels will be those that really understand their markets and use the understanding of their markets to understand how to revenue manage.
As we come out of this last recession, I think that it points more than ever at the importance of aligning yourself with high quality people. Because a smart asset manager wouldn't let their estate taxes go for a long period of time without them ever being questioned. A smart asset manager understands that when it comes to budget time, looking at the Smith travel forecasting, creating budgets that are workable for the following year, both up and down, only contribute to the hotel's success. The good brands, the high quality brands, the SFO stumble aside, the high quality brands will always drive a premium of return because they know what they're doing. And it's the same with a competent manager. If you have a competent manager that understands the market and understands the market dynamics, then you're going to do great when times are good, you're going to do fine when times are not. And everybody has to be tied to the same goal. And honestly, everyone should have the same risk and reward.
What is your message to the manager in the face of rising labor cost benefits, all that labor component, trying to motivate a battle-worn staff, and the market has some recovery fundamentals?
Yeah, I think as revenues were growing so quickly in 2006-07, that you became very aggressive in compensation to maintain top management, that you're constantly giving your managers, your department head, sales team, higher salaries. And one thing we've always advocated on the labor standards is that maintaining flexibility. We do a lot of our salaries with the 25% bonus potential, that a manager that has a successful year can earn a lot of money. But we have the downside protection that if things are less difficult, then compensation moves with the market. And that's a lot easier than going back to a manager and saying, we're going to cut your salary. And it's interesting, we've seen operators do that, that think that a hotel that's making $5 million revenue, I'm going to take $5,000 or $10,000 away from my GM because I want to pinch pennies and expect that they'll get better motivation from that. So I think doing a compensation that gives you the flexibility to move with the market. One thing we've done in a lot of the limited service hotels, we have outsourced the room attendant function to third-party companies where we pay a fixed fee per room. The biggest question with that is, can we maintain the service levels the brand expects? And we've had better success because you're having teams that are trained on a broader scale that you just can't do at one property. That's been very helpful to us. Some of the areas like unlimited service, we've gotten rid of the traditional job roles: executive housekeeper, a chief engineer, front desk manager. We have a room care manager, a guest care manager, and we do hybrid roles that gives us the flexibility to work in this environment. So being creative on how you go about your label model and your cost model. You know, one thing, we had a hotel that was trying to get business from China. It was a factory training for 2 years that would fill up 30% of their hotel, and they're competing against apartments, and we got creative and said, why don't we put integrated Skype phones in the hotel so the Chinese workers can call anytime, give them wireless. It doesn't cost us money, it's a little more creative. And we did that and we won the business there.
Cash.
Yeah. So, you know, we give you the flexibility. Another thing that I don't see in a lot of hotels is a consistent incentive program. Whatever you launch out to your managers, every person at a hotel should have an incentive. From a room attendant to a front desk worker to your managers. It should be clearly defined, clearly posted, and you have to follow through.
I'm going
to
jump ahead and kind of use the baseball game analogy of what inning are we in now? We singing the national anthem, or in the first inning, in the ninth inning, is it game over?
I'm not sure we're playing ball yet, so maybe it's spring training. Because it just doesn't feel like, I'm in an inning of a real game. And certainly at the beginning, I guess, of this cycle, I think the fundamentals have at least are now sort of spreading across the country. And if we look at the fundamentals, we measure them, which I don't know why we only focus on revenue, you know, RevPAR. We need to have a fundamental that focuses on, you know, GOPAR or something that looks at overall profitability in the industry. Simply having a mindset on RevPAR is, I think, a bad guide. RevPAR certainly had that point of inflection occurred during the first quarter, it seems, throughout the country, and it's starting to spread now into other markets. That being led, which we've talked about, by occupancy. Some markets, such as in New York and actually Boston and a couple of others, are showing actual rate growth. So we're at the early part of the tail end of spring training, or the beginning of the real baseball season.
We're seeing, the third party providers and websites, there's just way too many rooms going out on those channels. So the more operational assessments that we do and as we work on our asset managed properties, we're really driving home to these guys that you've got to focus on the more profitable channels and try to get the Expedias and the Travelocities out of the overall mix on the top line. And then on the bottom line, definitely focus more on trying to hold on to some of the innovative cost containment initiatives that are in place, the innovative model, labor model changes like you just talked about, and hold on to those and don't let, the memory just completely slip away as things do get better.
I like to preface it that my office is our baseball fanatics, and I grew up learning about cricket, so I don't know if my attitude will work. we had the keynote speech at lunch, and it was an amazingly demotivational perspective on things that we can't control as hotels. And I think I would say, in a baseball game, we're in a rain delay. Get your team ready, get the equipment there, get ready to go to bat, and there are going to be things outside of control that we have to wait and be quick to react and be introspective about it. The reality is that the best operator out there, the worst operator out there, you're going to be beholden to what's going to happen with lenders and financing. What is your exit strategy for a hotel? What factors you can't control? So do what you can with your means and wait for the rain to stop and move quickly.
I actually prefer a triple header at Wrigley. And my triple header has three components to it. I think there's a revenue game, and I think the revenue game, we're very, very early. I mean, maybe we're first, second inning. We've got a lot of room to run. We've got a lot of smarts that they can put in place to really get that back. In the cost-cutting game, I think we're pretty much tapped out. Hopefully, we're in the eighth or ninth inning, and we may even see a need to see, particularly in the high-end hotels, some reset. We didn't talk at all about, whether some of the things that happened in the luxury hotels and luxury resorts ultimately drive customers back down the chain because they're not providing what you expected in those kinds of hotels. I think that may be revisited. And I think there's also capital markets game, which I think, I never would have been smarter to think of it, but that one's clearly in a rain delay. And I don't think anybody knows kind of where the economy's headed, and nobody knows where real estate pricing and valuation really goes in the near term. Clearly, long term, we'll get value back, but in the near term, who knows?
I think this is the first inning of the playoffs. I take a more optimistic view, which is maybe the regular season has come and gone, and the weaker players have gone to the minors, and now we're in the play in the playoffs against the stronger players, and we have to be ready to take it all the way to the series.
I'm going to go ahead and open up the panel to any questions our audience has. There's one off in the corner.
Yeah, as far as from your perspective as asset managers, at what point do you guys draw the line for outsourcing some of the traditional hospitality, call them responsibilities or programs, whether it be your mechanical systems down to reservations, down to, I heard, housekeeping and bell services?
Keeping your core, well-trained, highly motivated staff members, and they'll take you through the down part of the seasonal cycle, and there's perhaps an opportunity to add that variable element from an outsourcing operation. And you're typically wanting to do it in areas that don't have the technical aspects that an engineering department may have.
No brainers, if you don't have a huge operation, like some of the gentlemen on this panel, where accounting at the property is non-accretive to the way you take care of your customer revenue generation, we advise clients to outsource that. They can do it cheaper, more effectively, and reduce the administrative time and management staff, so accounting and payroll. And one thing we do is the ramp-up periods are different. You know, we may have a full-service hotel that has a staff of three people, but for that 90 days before opening, the 6 months after, to build awareness, we'll bring in, you know, contract work to help list the market. But I think Chad hit it on the nail. Is you cannot compromise service or revenue strategy.
Well, I'd like to thank Bob, Barry, Sanjeev, Justin, and Chad.